Rufus Oldenburger was ahead of his time for automatic control. He got his degrees in mathematics. It was not engineering. And so it's interesting that that he ended up in a mechanical engineering department, not in a math department. He spent a fair number of years at Woodward Governor Company. They were dealing with very practical problems on real systems, on real machines, but they needed a way of understanding the behavior of these systems that only somebody with some math background could appreciate. So he brought in that flavor of things, but in having worked there, it also made him appreciate the importance of taking and applying that math to something real, to something physical. He recognized that more and more mechanical systems were going to be affected by controls, and so he decided not only to introduce a course in controls to mechanical engineers here at Purdue, but to make it a required course.
As I recall, the test on that subject was to factor a sixth or seventh or higher order equation all in an hour. This was something that I had never seen anybody else do. So he looked at it from the mathematical standpoint rather than frequency analysis.
I decided to go to graduate school after I graduated from Duke with a BSME. Read of Rufus Oldenburger at Purdue. I called him up personally and said I'd like to come and work for him. But Dr. Oldenburger had just gotten a major grant from NASA. This was the age of Sputnik and the US's response to, oh my God, Russia is going to beat us, okay? Russia with a satellite, we didn't have one. The demand for controls really accelerated. If you're going into space, you better have pretty precise control. When you cut that rocket engine off is very important. And so automatic control was a major, relatively new field. He was theoretical. Doing experimental work was relatively new to him. There was a large laboratory on the main floor. We had high pressure hydraulic pumps, a control panel, analog computer, and an oscilloscope, and a frequency generator. Here is the large reservoir of hydraulic fluid, the hydraulic pump, and a large motor. So it was a constant speed motor, and you varied the pressure by this, and then that fed into this panel, which you controlled into the experiment that you were doing. We were talking about major experiments, high frequency excitation of hydraulic lines and measuring the frequency response. You had to learn the theory and be able to work it mathematically and verify it experimentally. The control engineer must learn the equations of almost every system because you don't know what you're going to be controlling. A car, power plant, electricity. He met with us routinely, going over our work and the results and guiding us and say, well, you've done this, why don't you try that? His attention to rigor and precision influenced his students. He mentored them well, and most got excellent jobs when they left. Automatic control was a major discipline worldwide. And the Russians were very big in it because they were leading, particularly in the mathematical aspects of it. And Oldenburger had been to Russia and knew Russian people, and so he was very accepted there.
Yeah, he did quite a bit of traveling to Europe, to Paris. I remember we were just in the Japanese government. Then we went to India, and we guested to the Indian government in Oslo, Norway, where I think he was a guest of the king.
The control community needed sort of a common voice and a forum to get together. And keep in mind, this was the peak of the Cold War. He took the politics out and said, look, we are just interested in the science and in the understanding of the concepts. He conceptualized the idea of the International Federation for Automatic Control, this international group of people that would get together periodically to share ideas, concepts about control. And so he was one of the founders of IFAC. It's a great opportunity to get folks together. And I think the first time that the folks from the U.S. could meet up with some of the names they had heard about, see these people face to face instead of just reading about them, was quite a big deal. And so, Oldenburg was instrumental in recognizing the need and doing something about it and getting these people together. And I think the very first IFAC meeting actually took place in the Soviet Union. So again, giving folks elsewhere the opportunity, first opportunity, I think, to get inside that culture and have an opportunity to meet with those people. We have these fora where we can get together and share ideas that have been going on literally every year since the very beginning. You get to meet people from chemical engineering, from electrical, from every other, area that does controls that we would never otherwise have the opportunity, or would be very unlikely that we would meet them. But it turned out he studied Dutch, German, French, Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, Russian, Japanese, modern and ancient Greek and Latin, and lectured in several of those languages. So it just baffles me that somebody could have that much room in their brains to do all of that. So anyway, he must have been quite a phenomenal person.
I remember Oldenburger buying a 56 Thunderbird with, I think, the round windows, and how proud he was of that.
Oh yeah, it was a beautiful white car, a very pretty car. It was hardtop white, and he had designed the speed control for that vehicle.
You just look at an automobile, every day there's something else that's automated or that's computerized or controlled in some way. Fuel injection for the engine, ABS braking systems, traction control systems, stability control systems, and of course with the advent of all this autonomous stuff where you add even more sensors for vision, radar, LIDAR. So controls is prevalent. We thought, we really need to introduce this concept of control early on. It's so fundamental. We've introduced them to a fairly sophisticated microcontroller that they can program to not only collect information from the environment, but also act on the appropriate action that they're looking for. They can use it for remote control because it's got Wi-Fi accessibility. And so they can do essentially autonomous control if they want. They can do remote control if that's what they're interested in. It gives them a lot of capability. It really, I think, sets them up to be knowledgeable about all the kinds of software programming and just the wherewithal of sensing, actuation, and controller design.
The interesting thing about automatic control is it's a theory. And the theory became owned by everybody by the mid-70s. Everybody knew the theory and the mathematics of automatic control, no matter what field you were in.
Rufus Oldenburger passed away in 1969. When they decided to provide an award for a control engineer, they decided who better to name this award after than Rufus Oldenburger. Because Oldenburger was here at Purdue, we invited medal winners to come to campus to offer an Oldenburger lecture here at Purdue and talk about their work and talk about it in a more general way to a more general audience. So not focusing so much on the details of the control theory, but giving people an appreciation for what they accomplished, just so that people have a chance to meet them and say, here is a world-renowned figure, but also for them to share their wisdom, especially the students, for them to recognize that there are real people behind those ideas and being able to talk to them face-to-face. He was ahead of his time, and I think Purdue has that legacy to cherish as well, because we've had the study of controls and mechanical engineering ever since. That's, I think, a legacy to Oldenburger, recognizing the value of getting people together.